Well, everyone, thank you so much for coming in and for typing in where you're from. It's great to see so many familiar names. Katie, you want to get us started here? We'll start on time almost.
Sure. All right. Now that we're ready to go, I'll say it again. It's so good to see all of your names pop up. Hello. Thank you so much for joining us. I'm Katie Fleming, Community Engagement Director.
And I'm Michelle Vecved, our Director of Philanthropy. We are so excited to welcome you to this annual meeting. And we would like to begin by acknowledging that we gather today on ancestral homelands of the Coast Salish peoples who have lived in the Salish Sea Basin throughout time immemorial, throughout the San Juan Islands and in the North Cascades watershed from time immemorial. Please join me in expressing our deepest respect and gratitude for our Indigenous neighbors, for their enduring care and protection of our shared lands and waterways.
This is a meeting like nothing we've done before, but it's also a year like nothing we've ever had before. We've missed our member boat trips, hiking on Jones, and being together as community. We're going to hear from our president, Janet Alderton, and our new executive director, Brent Lyles. Our staff will also speak to the measurable outcomes of our work and what's on the horizon. We're recording this event for the members who can't be here tonight, as well as live streaming on YouTube.
This year, we have adapted to many changes and continued uncertainty. We hope this meeting shows our resiliency and it gives you hope for the future of protecting our islands. We're sharing what we've accomplished and we are asking for your continued support to protect and restore the San Juan Islands and the Salish Sea.
We hope you enjoy this evening's presentation and stick with us for some surprise cameos and community conversation at the end. Now, I'd like to introduce you to our board president, Janet Alderton.
Thank you, Katie. Thank you, Michelle. Here we are at Wautmau Bay, one of the very special places in our islands at the southern end of Lopez. Welcome to our members and our soon-to-be members. I serve on the board of the Friends of the San Juans because our work helps protect what I love about our islands and the Salish Sea. As a biologist, I believe that identifying the ecologically most important lands and waters can help guide our actions and the decisions within our county government and the wider region. Your membership in the Friends of the San Juans shows that you care about protecting our islands for people and for nature. Thank you. And now, this clip describes the origin of the Friends of the San Juans. One of our founders, Mike Krieger.
Potential earnings, and probably they were right. Gene Knapp then was the county prosecutor, and he was by himself, and he had no special background in land use law.
All that Gene had was one secretary who had one typewriter, and that was it. So to defend the original comp plan, he needed allies and an organization and a fundraising mechanism, and that's what the Friends of the San Juans did. One of the frustrations of being a land use attorney, land use environmental attorney, is that you've got this pot of gold, which in our case is the San Juan Islands, and you're protecting it. And if you win, nothing changes. If you win, it's still there. But if you ever lose, that gold is taken away and it's gone forever. So you can't ever afford to lose.
And doesn't this speak to all we still face today? And here we stand with your full faith in all our endeavors. Thank you. And now I am pleased to introduce our executive director, who will continue to build on our mission and our vision, Brent Lyles.
Hello, my name is Brent Lyles, and I have the great honor of serving as executive director of Friends of the San Juans. I want to thank you for joining in tonight, for taking time out of your Sunday evening to learn about the important work that's happening right now across the San Juan Islands and beyond to restore our forests and shorelines, to keep our seas and marine ecosystems healthy, and to help our communities thrive. I want to take a moment to acknowledge how humbling and incredible it is to recognize my own role as a new steward of these lands and waters, which are breathtaking and which for thousands of years have been cared for with intention and balance by the Coast Salish peoples, both before the arrival of European colonists and continuing today. In my first couple of months on the job, as I've really dug in and learned about the Friends programming and impact, I've been so impressed, not just with the quality and rigor of the work, which is amazing, but also with a strong sense of community and collaboration. This is not work that happens in isolation. We can't do it alone, and we don't. Here at Friends of the San Juans, not only do we have a long list of organizations and agencies that we are actively partnering with, but we also collaborate with you, our supporters and members. This is your work. I've had the chance to meet so many of you over the last 2 months, and I've heard the passion and excitement that you have for this work. Together, we are protecting and restoring the San Juan Islands and the Salish Sea, and we're also fighting the big fight, doing what we can to avert catastrophic changes to our climate and our planet. You are here tonight because those things are important to you. And whether you volunteer or financially support Friends of the San Juans, you are taking a tangible step both to protect our islands and our communities and also to fight climate change. I wish so much that we could all gather together tonight in person. I look forward to a time when we can do that again. And in the meantime, I hope you enjoy tonight's program. We are sharing the successes from just a few of our programs and also asking for your support for our work in the coming year. This has been a very challenging year, and next year will be challenging too, but the work doesn't stop, and the needs are growing. Working together with you, we can and we will make tangible, measurable progress and have even more successes in the coming year. At the end of tonight's presentation, stick around for an optional Q&A with our staff. We'd love to hear your thoughts and answer your questions. Again, thanks so much for being here, and thanks for joining us in this work.
Thank you so much, Brent. I am pleased to introduce Lovell Pratt, our Director of Marine Protection and Policy. This first segment is about our Healthy Seas program area. In this clip, Lovell shares how we take action to protect what you love. She draws the link between your support and our work as a small nonprofit addressing big issues like shipping and terminal projects that would affect the Salish Sea.
Hello, everyone. My name is Lovell Pratt, and I'm the Marine Protection and Policy Director here at Friends of the San Juans. One of the things that I do to fulfill our mission to protect the San Juan Islands and the Salish Sea for people and nature is to monitor all the large commercial shipping and refinery and oil transshipment facilities throughout the Salish Sea, both here in Washington State and in British Columbia. I want to tell you now about one project in particular. Canada has proposed to construct a new container ship terminal, the Roberts Bank Terminal 2, in the middle of the Fraser River Delta. On top of the water, it would be 437 acres on top of critical habitat for the critically endangered southern resident killer whale, critical habitat for salmon, and also for migratory birds. They use the Fraser River Delta as a critical stopover on their flights to and from the Arctic. Roberts Bank Terminal 2 would be a deep water port that could accommodate the largest container ships, the megamax size of container ships. One concern about these very large container ships is that they're more difficult to navigate because of their size. Container ships are not required to have tug escorts through the narrow passageways of the Salish Sea. Friends of the San Juans has been engaged in the environmental review process for the Roberts Bank Terminal 2 proposal since 2015. Last year, in 2019, we traveled to Canada to testify before the Federal Review Panel. We spoke in opposition to the project and raised many concerns about the project, and we urged them to not recommend approval for the project. However, we told the panel that if the project was to be approved, we would like to see them require three additional conditions to the permit. One would be to require an additional emergency response towing vessel stationed in the islands that could respond to a container ship in distress, especially in Harrow Strait and Boundary Pass at Turn Point, which is a difficult navigation area, in case a vessel was to lose steerage or otherwise become in distress. The emergency response towing vessel could go to its aid and prevent it from getting into an accident and causing an oil spill. The Niobe rescue tug at the entrance to the Strait of Juan de Fuca has had good success responding to vessels in distress and preventing accidents and oil spills in the Strait of Juan de Fuca and the outer coast. But the Niobe rescue tug is stationed at too great a distance to be able to respond in time to vessels in distress at Turn Point in Harrow Strait, Boundary Pass, or in the lower Georgia Strait. In addition, we ask that they require vessels that call on Roberts Bank Terminal 2 to be certified as quiet. The vessel traffic that would call on this port would impact southern resident killer whales in terms of their vessel noise and presence, impacting the southern residents' ability to catch scarce prey and to communicate and socialize with each other. And then the third request that we asked for is to require vessels calling on Roberts Bank Terminal 2 to be required to only use low sulfur diesel fuel for propulsion and not the heavy fuel oil that container ships continue to use. A diesel oil spill would cause significant environmental impacts, but would not be as bad as a spill of heavy fuel oil, a heavy viscous oil that would cause significant environmental and economic impacts if spilled. We were not successful in our advocacy with Canada's Federal Review Panel, and we felt that they really didn't address the impacts that this project would cause to all of us here in Washington State, our public and private shoreline properties, cultural values, tribal treaty rights, so many things that just were not addressed adequately in the environmental review for the project proposal. We drafted a letter to Governor Inslee, and 40 organizations from this area in Washington State signed on to it, asking Governor Inslee to engage on our behalf and to oppose Roberts Bank Terminal 2, and that if Canada insists on approving this project, in spite of our opposition, to request the three additional conditions that I outlined to you. If Roberts Bank Terminal 2 is approved and constructed, it would generate up to 520 additional container ship transits a year. Additional transits of container ships that carry between 1.5 and 4.5 million gallons of propulsion fuel. Container ships that would not be required to have tug escorts like tanker ships do. And the increase in the risk of accidents and oil spills could be detrimental to our southern resident killer whales and all of the marine fauna and flora in the Salish Sea, and to all of us who live here and rely upon the health of the Salish Sea for our well-being and for our economy, for our environment. If you haven't had an opportunity to take action with regard to Roberts Bank Terminal 2, I urge you to go to our website and go to the action page. It'll give you all the information you need to contact our governor and to contact the ministers in Canada. And also it includes a link to a petition that individuals can sign that says much the same as the letter that Friends of the San Juans and the 40 organizations sent to Governor Inslee. I'm recording this video on November 2nd, and as of this day, 72,163 people have signed this petition urging Governor Inslee to say yes to southern residents and no to the Roberts Bank Terminal 2. And that if Canada is going to proceed with approving this project, that they require additional mitigations. It's an amazing amount of support that we've received for this petition, and it's a testament to how much people care around the world about the southern resident orca and how much they understand about the impacts these new container ship projects, vessel traffic projects have on the southern resident killer whales. Thank you so much for your support of Friends of the San Juans and for your support of this work. I'm happy to provide any additional information and talk with anyone further, and you can contact me, level@sanjuans.org. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Lovell. As of tonight, there are 75,914 signatures on that petition. That is a direct result of our efforts to take action and ensure issues of significant environmental impact are at the forefront of discussions with decision makers. Now, here's another example of our work. I am really fortunate to work closely with Katie Fleming. She is our community engagement director. In this next segment, Katie shares her commitment to mentoring the next generation. And I've witnessed her work with students. She has this steadfast enthusiasm and she has unwavering passion. She sees the power that these students have in their interest and their passion. And she swiftly guides their skills towards greater impact as well as lifelong environmental stewards. Let's listen to Katie and hear why this work is important to Friends and our future.
Hi, I'm Katie Fleming, our Community Engagement Director. One of the best parts of my job is when I get to work with young people, either here locally in San Juan County or through my work at Western Washington University. Protecting the environment and mentoring youth to take action is the heart and soul of my job. It is so inspiring to see these students and their dedication and their interest and their energy to take action and create change. I see that it's my job to harness their superpowers to help them do even more. I'm incredibly fortunate to get to work with the young people I get to work with, and they give me so much hope for the future of my own young children. We need our young people to be engaged at every level to help protect the environment. Our youth need skills to engage, whether it's planting beach grass in a shoreline habitat to learning how to public speak so they can better inform and influence policymakers. At Friends, we cultivate a plan of action with and for students. It can start as simply as helping students organize a volunteer beach cleanup. And then from there, it can grow exponentially. Take, for example, last winter, we took a group of students from Friday Harbor High School down to Olympia. They talked to legislators to help inform policy about climate change, to waste reduction. They also testified for a bill to make the tardigrade the state microanimal. It was a really great trip for the students, but it was also really awesome to see how inspired the legislators were by having them there and listening to them and hearing what they care about and how they think about their future. Here's a short video about that trip.
My favorite part of the trip was testifying for the tardigrade to be our state microanimal.
Being able to witness and be a part of the process and also being able to meet with our representatives.
Being able to come to the Capitol and testify for tardigrades.
My absolute favorite part of this trip has been getting to talk to Deborah Lekanoff. She is one of the most powerful women I've ever met, and it's really cool to see her doing everything. Her walk, even her walk, is incredibly powerful.
My favorite part of this trip was listening to Alex Rammel testify for climate action.
My favorite part of this trip has been being able to witness the hearing for the low carbon fuel standards.
It was simply awesome to witness these students in Olympia, to witness the mentoring work that I've been doing with some of them for 4 years spring to life. They are such good communicators. They're finding their voices. They're able to advocate for what they believe in, for what they know science backs. They are becoming the change and informing the change that they want to see locally and globally. Here's a little bit from Alex Rammel, the legislator who worked with us when we were in Olympia on the tardigrade grade bill and also on talking about climate action and legislation.
Well, I'd start off saying just that it's really valuable, I think, for legislators to hear from, you know, representatives of future generations. We spend a lot of time sort of thinking about what kinds of policies will be good for the future, but hearing directly from those voices, I think, is really important. And honestly, not a lot of groups do that. Not a lot of students get to come to the legislature, and so it's a cool experience, I think, for the students. But I think it's also really valuable for us to hear from them, because frankly, so many of the people walking around the halls in Olympia are lobbyists that we hear from every day, and it's really valuable to get those voices. So yeah, I mean, I think Friends of the San Juans program is particularly cool because there's so many good ways to plug in to the civic process, whether it's coming and talking to a legislator directly or speaking to committees, sending letters, sending emails, making phone calls. All of those things are good ways to plug in. And Friends has been helpful at getting those voices into the halls of power, if you will, in all of those different ways. You know, we'll be looking for ways to connect with people, and Friends has done a good job of taking advantage of that accessibility and making sure, you know, these students who are at this point where they're just starting to think about how they could be involved in civic life, like giving them some of those opportunities to put their foot in that door and see what it's like, I think will lead to adults who know how to participate, who know the importance of voting, know the importance of connecting with their civic leaders. Some of them, I imagine, I hope, will run for office themselves one day, in part because of that experience.
Thank you so much to Alex and the other legislators who worked with us while we were in Olympia. Friends of the San Juans is going to continue this work with students for our shared future. Just this fall, we helped the Spring Street class, the environmental systems class, organize a youth forum to help educate our community about where the county council candidates stood on environmental issues. It was a great experience for the students, for the candidates, and for our community who got to learn more through the questions these students asked. So that's just one example of another recent project we've done. Again, engaging students in not only actions they can do in their own lives, but this larger level of policy and how they can play a role in informing and engaging with our community and legislators. Together, we are creating change. We are creating change by helping our future generation engage as much as they can in important efforts, informing initiatives from everywhere from local waste reduction to global climate change. These students are already making a difference, and your support is helping us make that happen. Thank you so much.
Good evening. I'm George Lawson. I've been connected to Lopez Island since 1969, and for the past 15 years, I've served on the board of the Friends, as president, and I'm currently a strategic advisor. Each year, I make a generous gift to the Friends because it's the one organization where I can actually follow the money from my checkbook to observable, measurable outcomes, like bull kelp beds, the Chinook salmon, the preservation and restoration of southern resident orcas. Will you join me this year in making a sacrificial gift to the support of one of the most beautiful, precious, fragile monuments to nature on Earth?
Hi, we're Deb and Glenn Burles. We've lived on the west side of San Juan Island since 2011. We chose to live here because of its natural beauty, and we want to preserve it for future generations. We built a LEED Platinum home, and we're part of the Green Shores Initiative.
Living where we do, we have a bird's eye view of our ecosystem and the threats to it. Over the last several years, we've noticed a significant drop-off in the number of days that our resident orcas visit, a significant reduction in the number of fishing days for our commercial fishing fleet, an increase in the amount of coastal development, and an increased amount of shipping traffic. These things are linked. Insensitive development along the coastline can ruin habitat for our forage fish as well as our juvenile salmon. That combined with ship noise and agricultural runoff from different parts of the Salish Sea can combine to further threaten our salmon stocks and the number of days our residents actually visit us. Then considering planned expansions of area refineries and the amount of increased tanker traffic that goes with that, the threat of a major spill goes up dramatically. But that's where the Friends come in. Since their inception, they've been the guardians of the Salish Sea and this place we call home. They educate, they advocate, they adjudicate, and sometimes they even excavate. They provide a focusing agent to protect and preserve this jewel that we live on and protect it for future generations.
This is why we donate to Friends of the San Juans. and we invite you to join us. We recognize that the pandemic has caused financial hardship, and there are the critical needs that require resources. But time doesn't stand still. The threats continue, and the time for action is now. Please consider a generous donation to the Friends of the San Juan. Thank you.
Thank you, Glenn and Deb. And now it's time to mix it up a little bit. We have a quick intermission and a word from the Barnacle on Orcas Island. They're going to show us how to make tonight's special drink, the Apple Jack Rabbit.
Hi, I'm Tara from the Barnacle in East Sound. Now's a really great time for you to refresh your drink. Today we're going to make the Jack Apple Rabbit using Orcas Island Distillery's award-winning apple brandy. If you want, you can come along on this ride with me and we'll make it together. We're going to start by taking a chilled coupe glass. To get that chilling, we're going to just put a little bit of ice in there and a splash of water so that that'll chill while we build our cocktail. You're going to have some Boston shaker with some ice in it, and we're going to take 2 ounces of that apple brandy that I was telling you about. Now, this apple brandy is a wonderful product. It stands alone. You can sip it just how it is at the end of the meal, but today we're going to add it with some fresh squeezed orange juice, 3/4 of an ounce. So that's 2 ounces of apple brandy, 3/4 of an ounce of fresh squeezed orange juice, and another 3/4 of an ounce of fresh squeezed lemon. So this is going to give it a little acidity to help balance the drink. Add to that 1/2 ounce of maple syrup, always organic. Pop your top on and give it a good shake. That water will dilute just slightly and make sure that all the ingredients come together and chill. Now that our coupe is nice and chilled, that's plenty of time for it. We're gonna go ahead, get that ice out of there, and double strain our beautiful honey-colored Apple Jack Rabbit cocktail. It's a beautiful honey color if it's done right. And there you have it. Thanks so much for your support of the Friends of the San Juans. Cheers.
I am super excited to share this clip from Jenny Barcelos, our staff attorney. Jenny is a passionate, devoted environmental advocate who works so hard to make our community a better place. I've been honored to work with her. The story she's about to tell you is a story of monumental impact through Friends work. It is by all accounts an example of the strength, vision, and potential we hold with our staff of 9, along with your support. It's also an example of how our work addresses both local and global actions to climate change.
Hi there, I'm Jenny Barcelos, staff attorney for Friends of the San Juans, and I'm here today to share a bit more about our Phillips 66 case, which is in current litigation right now. So for those of you who don't know about this case, let me start at the beginning. In 2019, the Phillips 66 Ferndale Refinery applied to Whatcom County for a permit to install a brand new 300,000 barrel crude oil storage tank and a new 80,000 barrel fuel oil storage tank as part of a new IMO fuel project that the refinery was taking on. So Friends, along with a lot of other environmental organizations, looked into the project and the permit applications, looked into the SEPA checklist, wrote comment letters to Whatcom County. And even though there were many great letters, including some by some of you, I imagine, Whatcom County ultimately decided to issue a revised MD&S in August of 2019, not really accounting for the impacts, the vessel traffic impacts to Southern residents. Now, Lovell on our team in particular felt like this was an egregious error on behalf of Whatcom County. And so we decided after careful consideration to appeal this MD&S. So we filed an appeal in Whatcom County, and in early November last year, we had a hearing before the Whatcom County Hearing Examiner, where we had a 4-hour long hearing with us and Whatcom County's prosecutor's office and Phillips 66's attorneys. That hearing was so interesting. The kinds of information that we were able to gather and observe from Phillips 66 about the way they operated and the kinds of information that they share with different government agencies and bodies was very eye-opening for us as a small NGO. But ultimately, the most interesting thing that happened was that we were victorious at the end of that hearing. So we happened to have the newly appointed head of the Washington State Bar Association serve as our hearing examiner in this matter. And he took his time going through the thousands of pages of the record and the 4-hour long testimonies and hearing materials. He took his time to make a decision in this matter, and it was largely in our favor. Well, shortly before Christmas, Phillips 66 decided to appeal this hearing examiner's decision to Whatcom County Superior Court. So they filed a LUPA petition, a Land Use Petition Act petition, arguing that the hearing examiner's decision was unfounded on a whole host of grounds. And we have been in litigation in this matter ever since. So in the winter and spring, we were busy briefing the case. And then on June 4th, we had a hearing before Superior Court, before Judge Freeman in Whatcom County Superior Court. And I just wanted to read a little bit of my opening statement from that hearing, because it gives you a sense really of how Friends acts before a court when representing the environment. I think there's no better way for you to know what goes on other than hearing me read this. Okay, so again, opening statement, June 4th, 2020, before the Whatcom County Superior Court, Judge Freeman. Thank you, Your Honor. I represent Friends of the San Juans, a 41-year-old grassroots organization dedicated to protecting and restoring the San Juan Islands and the Salish Sea for people and nature. We restore habitat and protect water, forest, farmland, and endangered species, while building thriving communities in the San Juan Islands through education, science, advocacy, and citizen engagement. We're here today representing the 72 surviving wild southern resident killer whales, which call the Salish Sea home. This endangered species, iconic in our region, does not have any other voice in this matter. Now, I won't go on and bore you going into all of the issues that we presented in this matter, but I want you to understand that Friends, acting alone as a small environmental organization, was able and has been able to represent the surviving population of the southern resident killer whale in a courtroom. When you step back for a second, you can understand the significance of this. Interestingly enough, we had a follow-up hearing to this hearing, this June hearing, on September 11th of this year, so just about a month and a half ago. And we, in this September 11th hearing, Judge Freeman issued an oral decision that essentially gave Friends and Whatcom County a victory in this matter. We have not received the written decision, so I don't want to go too far into detail, but ultimately, our arguments were found to be persuasive in almost all of the issues briefed. So what does that mean? Well, we're waiting for a written decision. And we're waiting also, once we get that written decision, to see if Phillips 66 will now appeal this case to the Washington State Court of Appeals. That's totally up in the air. The other interesting thing to note is that this project, which would have increased the storage capacity at this local refinery by almost 10%, has been put on hold for well over a year. So it's unclear to me how much money this has cost the refinery in terms of a delay for the project. It's unclear to me if this project will ever get built, but I think it's interesting to follow along and see what happens. Now, Friends wasn't fighting the project itself. I want to be clear. We have not filed an appeal to halt the project. We simply wanted Phillips 66 and the Ferndale Refinery to commit to providing adequate data on their vessel traffic. So right now, they have not agreed to do that, and that's what they're fighting in court. And without providing data on their vessel traffic, no one under the sun, especially not scientists who study southern resident killer whales, none of those people can evaluate the potential impacts to those whales without the data. So it's a really interesting thing to me that this refinery could have gone ahead. I mean, all they have to do is give the information. And they could have gone ahead and had their project up and running. They could be making money from this project. And they have chosen to fight us in court rather than move forward with the project. So that cost-benefit analysis is fascinating. That's not my area of expertise at all, but I think it's a really interesting set of circumstances that has come into play as a result of this lawsuit. So I want to reiterate, we are in active litigation on this matter. And what happened during the winter is that Whatcom County ultimately started working with Friends on this case. And we served as co-respondents in the Superior Court level of the case. Because Phillips 66 decided to fight the hearing examiner's decision, the Whatcom County hearing examiner's decision, Whatcom County ultimately wanted to stand up for their hearing examiner's decision. So they have sided with us, and we stand aligned on almost all of the issues in this matter. So it is now Phillips 66 against Whatcom County and Friends of the San Juans together, and we're waiting to see what happens next.
Thank you, Jenny. Our next segment is a story about how we will share the web of life below the surface of the Salish Sea with young people through virtual reality. This program was in planning stages even before COVID began. For Jess Newley, our marine science coordinator, it was a great way to get program content started while being socially distant. I love working with Jess. She's enthusiastic, creative, and dedicated to her work. It goes without saying that she is also fully and completely immersed in her work. Let's listen to her story about Friends' new virtual reality immersive education program.
Hi, I'm Jess Newley, Marine Science Coordinator. It's crazy that I have a position that allows me to fulfill my professional time with personal passion like education, film, photography, and spending as much time as I can in the Salish Sea. Sharing the Salish Sea with students is important to the mission of Friends because education programs like the VR immersive program will help inspire future stewards of our islands, protecting them for people and nature while giving them the tools to create change they want to see. Well, before COVID, virtual education was opening new doors to students everywhere. The idea of sharing what was under the Salish Sea and the ecological food chain was rapidly developing in sight of new technology and tools within reach of science teachers and students. To protect what we love, we need to harness the knowledge of how important it is.
Immersive education takes students on a journey underwater from the comfort of their home, even more important now during COVID times when life outside of Zoom needs to be experienced. Island students have read about forage fish, eelgrass, salmon, and orcas, seen photos and illustrations, but being immersed in these critical habitats among the special wildlife is a whole new experience. Students will receive virtual reality headsets in the mail along with a curriculum package that allows them to dive deeper on a personal level into our local marine food web. Hitting STEM benchmarks of science, technology, and education, students are guided through critical thinking lessons and then left to their own interests and devices to create an independent project, whether it be developing curriculum for younger students using the 360 video, going deeper into the technology aspect of this program, or an advocacy project like letter writing to local legislators. Moreover, students will be able to experience what it's like to be a field scientist, like the ones working on this eelgrass planting project in Westcott Bay this summer, exposing them to careers in science, technology, and education as well. The program is in the stage of development and will be piloted in 4 high schools in San Juan County and be ready for use in high schools around the region. We've received grants from the Wheeler Foundation and Keto Legacy Foundation to cover most of the equipment needs and staff time, and very much appreciate all who gave big to our Give Big campaign this year. This work is important to me personally because being able to share the beauty and awe experience under the surface is the whole reason I began underwater photography in the first place 10 years ago. And to be able to combine that with experiential education for local students, it's definitely my dream program. Now I'm going to take you on a little adventure upriver where the coho salmon are currently migrating to their native spawning grounds. The salmon story is what really connects us all on the islands to something much larger than us, like the entire Skagit watershed that we live at the base of. These salmon travel over 60 miles from the mouth of the river to the North Cascades, where I was filming for the past couple weekends in October and beginning of November. Being able to share this with you all tonight and with students and audiences around the region soon is why I do what I do and definitely love to do it. Now, don't all rush at once, but with your support tonight, we can bring more virtual reality headsets to more students and take them on even more transformative experience up the river, like it happened to me 8 years ago living in the North Cascades. And while we want to sincerely thank you for your support, here's a fun little show of gratitude from our Give Big as well.
I'm Mari Luz, and I'm standing here with Tom looking out over the Salish Sea. And both being healthcare professionals, we greatly value and appreciate working with other professionals, such as Friends of the San Juan, who are healthcare professionals for our environment.
We believe in giving to the Friends of the San Juans. We give sweat equity, we give annual giving, and legacy giving. Please join us.
Thank you so much, Tom and Maluz. Welcome back. All right, so our next segment is from Tina Whitman, and she is our science director. And I really appreciate her dedication to work, to the shorelines, to the science, and to the process. Tina is a force that parallels nature when it comes to restoration work. We told you a story earlier this year about Tina's forage fish surveys, and it was called Tides Wait for No One on a Sunday morning before sunrise. Now, it illustrated Tina's unusual office hours and her tenacity and commitment to science and research. This next clip is about our Susha project, and it exemplifies 7 years of Tina's dedicated work with community and partnerships to restore and connect a saltwater marsh on Susha Island to the Salish Sea for the first time in 75 years. This clip is an unforgettable example of Tina's commitment and our mission at Friends.
Hi, I'm Tina Whitman, Science Director here at Friends of the San Juans. Over 7 years ago, I started working on a project with state parks to restore salmon habitat on Susha Island. For people, Susha is one of our state's premier marine parks. For nature, the shorelines of Susha provide important habitat for juvenile salmon and forage fish. As most of you with us today are aware, our orca needs salmon. Salmon need forage fish, and forage fish need healthy beaches. In addition, the marine shorelines of the San Juans provide important rearing habitat for young salmon from rivers all across the region as they make their way to the open ocean. At the Susha site, the road and armoring buried and contributed to the degradation of important spawning habitat for forage fish. The road itself and the undersized perch culvert acted as a tidal barrier that limited fish passage and the many habitat benefits that wetlands provide to juvenile salmon. Lastly, the armored road prevented the beach and wetland from adjusting to sea levels, which over time would further reduce habitats and functions in a process known as the coastal squeeze. Over the past years, many, many years, was a lot of collaboration, research and design, and permitting. And over the past few months, the low-lying shoreline road, armoring, and culvert were removed, fully restoring salt marsh, tide channel, and beach habitat in support of forage fish, salmon, and orca. To restore the salt marsh, tide channel, and beach habitats in Mud Bay, which will directly support migrating juvenile salmon and critical forage fish, the entire low-lying causeway was removed to return the beach, marsh, and channel to more natural conditions. With help from the Civilian Conservation Corps, we replanted the restored beach berm with native plants. To allow this full restoration option, we installed a new inland access road to connect the park's maintenance buildings with the existing trail and road system. It has been amazing to experience the completion of this project that has been a focus for so many years. To personally witness the first high tides come in and connect the marsh and the marine shorelines unimpeded for the first time in over 75 years, it was so impactful. I was surprised by how moved we all were standing there at the site. It was a reminder of the power of water and nature in action. With your support, Friends can continue to take meaningful action like the project on Susha. With your support, we will work to protect and restore natural shorelines and support marine food webs. As a member of Friends, you are part of the solution, taking action to recover salmon and our southern resident orca. Thank you.
I'm proud to serve as Vice President of Friends, and this year, it has been my honor and my good fortune to step in as interim executive director through a time of uncertainty and transition. Friends has weathered the storms of 2020 in part for one other important reason. Our capital funds, provided through the generosity of our members, are invested in the greenest of green investment funds. We know that for every day of every week, including Christmas and the 4th of July, our investments are being steered into new ways to save the planet. Sarah and I make a recurring quarterly contribution to sustain the important work of Friends. Join us, and Friends will be working stronger than ever to protect what you love.
Thank you so much, Toby. Well, I hope that you enjoyed watching those tides literally come in and connect with the marsh in that time lapse that Tina provided. So we are coming down to the end of this program. Thanks for sticking with us. I want to introduce our last segment. As we near the end of the program, this segment is really most appropriately a reflection upon these amazing islands as seen through the eyes of Tor Hansen. Tor was born and raised in the Pacific Northwest. He lives on San Juan Island with his wife Eliza and their son. In a description of his childhood experience, we read about catching salmon, gardener snakes, hermit crabs, and I think tree frogs. And well, it illustrates why we must protect these idyllic islands. This is the legacy that we leave our children and the future. We now present our friend, author, and biologist, Tor Hansen.
Hi, I'm Tor Hansen, author, biologist, and longtime islander. As a kid around here, seeing orcas and catching fish was commonplace. Watching those opportunities diminish helped to cement my path as a scientist, as a writer, and as a supporter of the Friends of the San Juans. Today we've been hearing a lot of different perspectives on the work of the Friends, from salmon restoration to shipping policy to the nuances of environmental law. And that's as it should be. because the job of protecting these islands we love so much is as complex and varied as the islands themselves. And when we support a group like the Friends, we not only help out those famous endangered creatures and the wonderful island vistas that we love, we help places and habitats that we hardly ever bother to think about, places like treetops. I've climbed this Douglas fir to get a new perspective on my own backyard, and I'm already learning all sorts of new things. From up here, familiar backyard birds look totally different, not showy songbirds, but simply dark backs flitting through the green undergrowth. This is the way that hawks and falcons perceive them. And I found this twig, denuded by the caterpillars of a tussock moth, which is one of the only creatures of any size with a gut tough enough to digest mature conifer needles. And as I climbed the tree, all around me I was shaking loose the seeds from the cones, which, if you get close, turn out to be winged, just like maple seeds, so that they twirl through the air. Every habitat in these islands has such untold stories, from mossy rocks to beaches and stream beds to a handful of soil. We can never know it all, and that makes biology endlessly fascinating. But it also means that we can never know the full benefits and consequences of environmental protection. When we support a group like the Friends, we're doing more than we even know. That's exciting. This year marks 40 years that the Friends of the San Juans has been working to protect these beautiful islands. I say, here's to the next 40 and the 400 beyond that.
Thank you, Tor, for your support. Tor has an amazing ability to pull our attention to what is so important about our work of the last 40 years and what will continue to be important as we move into the next 40 or even 400. We're all looking forward to Tor's next book, too. It's about the biology of climate change, so make sure to watch the shelves of your local bookstores next year. This evening, you have heard about the challenges we have confronted, the restoration we have completed based on science, and the law and policy work that has helped to ensure healthy seas. You know our work and you understand the importance of continuing our work. Now, I'd like to introduce Michelle Vecved and Brent Lyles to share more about how you can help.
Thank you, Katie. Well, tonight, and I'm guessing on many occasions, all of you have witnessed or you have experienced these islands and these shorelines and maybe even seen orca. And you know why this work is so important. You've heard how this incredible staff, with their unique expertise and passion, are so dedicated to protecting what you love. You've seen our small organization reach for some big issues and impact in our state and across international borders. With actions and policy based on science and research, working together with you, we will continue this mission-driven work. We will restore shorelines, we'll mentor youth, we'll advocate for safe shipping and healthy seas.
This has been a difficult year for so many, yet we know there are threats to our fragile lands and waters, our community, and our planet, which cannot be ignored. I don't have to tell you that it is critical to have experienced staff and resources to perform the work that you've heard about tonight, and those were just a few of our programs. Starting this week and continuing over the next couple of months, we'll be embarking on a comprehensive strategy initiative for Friends of the San Juans. Through that planning process, we'll work with our community to develop our vision, objectives, and goals for the next 5 years. We'll be expanding our work to have even more impact and target that impact where we can make the most difference. We are going big in the coming year. And your financial investment is what makes our work possible. We have a year-end fundraising goal to support our programs and operations in the coming year. That goal, $225,000, is unflinching and meaningful. It represents almost 20% of our entire budget for the coming year. And to help us get there, tonight we are very pleased to announce a $100,000 match. What that means is that a group of our most passionate donors, including the Friends Board of Directors, has already pledged almost half of our year-end goal of $225,000. And it's a match challenge, so we need your help to unlock that match. Every donation you give tonight and through the end of this year will have double the impact, up to $100,000. We boldly ask you to consider a generous investment in Friends of the San Juans to help us carry out our mission for healthy seas, natural shorelines, and thriving communities. We'll make it easy for you. There's four different ways to send in your support. You can give by texting the word FRIENDS to 360-317-2610, and we'll put that number on the screen in just a moment. You can donate through our website at sanjuans.org. You can mail us a check, and also you can pledge your support by email. Just send me a note at brent@sanjuans.org. And of course, you can also reach out to me if you have any questions. Thank you for digging deep and making an impact. I'd like to send out my appreciation and thanks to our dedicated team of staff members at Friends of the San Juans, Jan, Jenny, Jess, Katie, Lovell, Michelle, Shannon, and Tina. And thank you to our members and the community support that helped us put this evening together. A very special thanks to Peter Kavanaugh for his talents, insight, and creativity tonight.
And thank you to our members who created personal testaments, Deb and Glenn Brules, George Lawson, Marluz Villa and Tom Reynolds, Toby Cooper, and the sincere and talented Tor Hansen, who soundly wraps up the beauty of our islands and the urgency to protect them. And thank you for the trust you place in our organization and in our hands to do all of this work.
For supporting our mission-driven programs and for protecting what you love.
And just to review, here are the four ways to give Brent just told you about. You can give by texting FRIENDS to 360-317-2610. You can donate through our website at sanjuans.org. Just look for the donate at the very, very top of the screen. And you can also pledge your support by email to brent@sanjuans.org. And then, of course, as he mentioned, you can do it the old-fashioned way by mailing a check to the address here, P.O. Box 1344, Friday Harbor, Washington, 98250. Thank you so much for joining us tonight and for your year-end support. We invite you to stick around to ask our staff questions. We will begin a three-minute timer, so get up, stretch your legs while our staff logs on, and please put your questions into the Q&A box. We're going to answer as many questions as we have time for, and then we'll copy the questions and follow up an email for those we are unable to answer tonight. See you in 3 minutes. Thank you.
Okay, looks like we're back with still quite a number of people, Katie, for our questions. I'm going to let you facilitate this and make sure we've got everybody in for panelists and questions.
Great. Okay, now the question is, do we have all of our staff here? What do you think, everybody? Are we missing anyone? Hi, everybody. All right, Michelle, you take a good look and see if you need to get in there and promote anybody up to a panelist, but I think we have everybody. Okay, well, we do have some questions here in the question and answer box. So here we go. And I wonder though, let's do just a quick introduction of everybody's faces. What do you all think? So the first person I see here, well, you know me, you know Michelle, you know Brent now, is Tina. Hi, Tina. Tina, our science director.
Hey, everybody. Great to see you, Tina from Orcas Island.
Okay, and Lovell, you want to introduce yourself?
Hi, everyone. Lovell Pratt from San Juan Island.
And Jess?
Hello, Jess Newley on San Juan Island.
And Jenny?
Hi there, Jenny Barcelos on Orcas Island.
Shannon?
Hi, Shannon Davis, Grants Manager, actually working from Port Townsend. And cheers to you all. There's my barnacle drink.
You're lucky. Awesome. Okay. All right. And then the one person we don't have, and I don't know if she's going to pop up here or not, is Jan, our operations manager. So she, if she doesn't pop up tonight, she's very much with us in spirit. So, okay. All right, well, let's see what we have here in our Q&A box. Our first question is for Lovell. So this is from Jean Helfman. Another concern for the Roberts Bank Terminal 2 is likely to be ballast water as a source of invasive species. More traffic means greater chance of introduction of invasives. Was anything said or done about that in the work you have done?
So Jean's right, ballast water is a real concern with the large commercial ships that call on ports throughout the Salish Sea. It's something that was, there are protocols in place and best practices in place, regulations, particularly with the International Maritime Organization with regard to treatment of ballast water to control for invasives entering into our local waters. But it is an ongoing concern, but it's also something that is actively being regulated at the international level.
Great. Thank you, Lovell. Okay, so let's see here. So Tina, from Toby Cooper, how long does it take for the Susha Marsh to recover fully?
Great question, Toby. And you know, all these research projects are a little bit of, and restoration projects are a little bit of a research project as well. So we'll be monitoring the project seasonally for the next 2 years, and then we'll come back annually. I'm looking at the changes to the tide channel and the vegetation and even the fish that are using the marsh. So it's a little bit of an open question, but right away, now that the tides are reaching the marsh, it's already, you know, sort of starting to heal. And again, we've unburied that habitat. So the re-access of fish passage was immediate. And some of the other changes may take a little longer, but we will be monitoring into the future.
Great. Thanks, Tina. Okay, and you know, let's see here. We'll get a new person up here, hasn't asked yet. So from Glenn Brules, Tina, this is for you too. Can you comment on your recent collaborations with the San Juan Preservation Trust? And where do you see that collaboration going in the future?
Sure. This project's been going for a number of years now, and it was recently in some of our local press. We've been working with the Preservation Trust, who obviously are holding lands in perpetuity through conservation easements or acquisition, and we've really helped them be more strategic about their shoreline protection, really identifying where are those last, best, most special places that we really need to partner with private landowners. With over 90% of our shoreline tax parcels in the county are on private property, we have to partner with landowners. That's a key part of the puzzle.
Where I see it going next, so we sort of just finished a big project at Mud Bay on Lopez, and there are more projects in the work. I was just working with the trust this week out doing new samples on some of their new properties on Orcas, and they've got new projects in the works that, again, we're providing kind of the scientific data to help them advance grants or their work with landowners to really protect those conservation values. So it'll be ongoing into the future.
Great. Thanks, Tina. Okay, and so this one is from Kaya Olson, and I think anybody who wants to jump in and answer this one about the work you're doing this year would be great. She says, and hi, Kaya, by the way, I'm so glad you're here tonight. Kaya was our intern, high school intern last summer with our Plastic Free Salish Sea program. So she's awesome, and here's what she wants to know from us. To all staff, what are some of the most significant upcoming projects Friends of the San Juans will be focusing on in the next year? Anybody want to go first? Jess, it looks like you want to.
I was just trying to read it more. Well, I mean, personally, the immersive education is going to be my big focus, especially in the beginning of the year, and be implementing into high schools around the islands. Other than that, more boater education for our Anchor Out and our Eelgrass program, and lots more other stuff I'm probably not thinking about right now. Thank you.
Anybody else want to jump in? Shannon, do you want to say anything about what you know about what's coming up at grants? Like, what do we have to get done, Shannon?
We have a lot to get done, Katie. You know that.
I do know that.
Well, I think Tina or Jess should speak to our eelgrass project that's going to be a big focus for the next 2 years, and our restoration cultivation work, where we are going to find those more restoration projects like the one we just completed in Susha. We have two in the works, one on Lopez and one on Shaw, that have been funded already, but there is more armoring and groins and other strange shoreline modifications out there that we want to find and talk to the property owners and bring our experts out to explore whether we can remove the damaging structures and bring in beach nourishment if that's necessary. And then we can, you know, we have funding to do the design work and even maybe permitting to get into the implementation stage, where we will then find other grant money to do the restoration implementation. So we have a lot of great work to do that, but so if anybody wants to know more about that or has shoreline property or neighbors, definitely contact us.
Yeah, and I could chime in just quickly. We do, Friends has a program where we offer free technical assistance to waterfront property owners. Anyone who's interested, it's a no strings attached site visit. It's also how we get to know folks and identify some of our restoration and protection project sites. And it's a great way to just learn more about your particular property and what you can do to help protect what you love.
And yeah. I can jump in quickly and, sorry, Brent, and say, you know, our youth program work, we're continuing to do what we can, right, in this virtual world that we live in. But just last week, we opened up beyond San Juan County to Kaya, who's now going to get some of her friends from Spokane involved. And so I'm pretty excited about using this kind of weird virtual world that we're in to our benefit by connecting more young people from across the state to do hopefully some policy work with the state legislator. And yeah, we'll go from there. Brent?
I'm especially excited, and I alluded to this a little bit earlier in some of my comments, but we're going to be doing strategic planning with the board and staff, with partners, and with community input. Our first planning meeting for that is actually this coming week. And we're going to be rolling out that process over the next, I don't know, probably 3 or 4 months. And, you know, keep an eye out for that. You know, right now we've got about 56 people tuning into this. And I hope that as you see opportunities to weigh in on the Friends and kind of moving forward, it's really important to us to hear from our supporters and get that input about what needs you're seeing out there in the community. So I'm super excited about that. That effort is going to help us clarify our vision for the next 5 years and, put objectives in place that are measurable, where we can really see that we're moving the needle on some of the most important challenges that are out there, both for our community and looking at our role in the climate change fight as well. I'm super excited about that. And we don't have the board here. We don't have our board of directors answering questions, but that is something they're excited about as well. So look for that. I'm looking forward to it. It's going to be fun.
Brent, anybody else? Level wants to go.
Yeah, I'll just add two things. One is that San Juan County is in the process of updating the comprehensive plan. And we've been working on that actively, providing comments to the Planning Commission and county staff and the council members on the various elements that are being updated. And there'll be more opportunity for more citizens to get involved as we move forward through the process. The timeline is that the update will be, it looks like it'll be, they're aiming to complete it in the spring or maybe the summer of next year. So we hope you'll be watching for opportunities to engage in that with us. That's a really important process in terms of our community, and it's where Friends of the San Juans got its start. So there's a lot of work to do there. And then in terms of the Healthy Seas program, I'm hoping to be able to work further and take more steps with regard to anchorage areas and the bunkering, the ship fueling that takes place in anchorage areas, and trying to provide more mitigations to ensure the safety of those operations that take place. Especially, we've got several relatively new anchorage areas near Vendovia Island, Jack Island, and near Padilla Bay that are especially of concern given the importance of the environment there. So, thanks.
Thanks, Lovell. Anybody else? Okay, well, let's see here. Lovell, before you turn up, and you already did, but Toby Cooper is wondering, has the governor responded to the petition?
No, not formally. Nope. We're still providing information to the staff there. So, and we'll have to be sending an update now that the petition numbers continue to go up.
Yeah, definitely. Okay, so this is from Leslie in Valviers. Can someone give an update on fish farming in these imperiled waters? For example, what happened with the salmon which escaped in the recent collapse over by Anacortes, and what does the future hold regarding fish farms in Washington?
I'll start. Tina, you chime in. So Cook Aquaculture, who operated the fish farm that was damaged and where the fish escaped, has put in an application to modify a permit so that they can raise steelhead, which is a native species. It would be all female steelhead instead of the Atlantic salmon that are currently raised in the net pens. And so that process is under review, and we've submitted comments to oppose that, because even though they would be changing the species of salmon, they would still be raising these salmon in these, basically they're animal feedlots, these confined nets with high concentration of fish, and the concern about diseases that could spread to the wild population of fish and the impacts to the ecosystem immediately around the net pen area. We're also supporting Wild Fish Conservancy. They've actually submitted a request to take over the leases of the net pens and to discontinue the net pens, which would be a win-win for the environment. But that's also in process, and we're supporting that effort and opposing the effort to continue with farming salmon in those net pens.
Yeah, great, Lovell. The only thing I would add to that too is just chiming in that we're, British Columbia is still really, really fighting the fight. They have a lot of fish farms up there and a lot of the sort of more intact native populations of salmon. So we're still really working across the border as well. It's really a broad coalition of folks really trying to get this net pen issue put to bed finally.
Okay. Thank you, Lovell and Tina. And I'll answer one from San and Corky Olson. They want to know when Friends is going to sponsor boat trips to Mud Bay and restoration on Susha. As soon as we can, as soon as we safely can take you out there, we will. Because yeah, it's definitely going to be something to see. Let's all keep our fingers crossed for next summer. That's what we would love to see happen.
Yeah, actually this year our planting of 4,000 dune grass plants was supposed to be a volunteer boat trip project. And I was super happy to have our dedicated Civilian Conservation Corps students from around the US, 10 of them, and they were hardcore workers. I think it would have been hard for us to get that done as a volunteer project, but we so miss being able to bring you all to the site. That was the plan, was to bring everyone there this October. So next October.
We'll get you there. Okay, so let's see here. How about from Valerie Chu? And Tina, this is for you. So Tina, what can we do to restore, protect shorelines and Hood Canal for forage fish populations? She knows that there's heavy pushback in the area.
Yeah, you know, all across Puget Sound, the same kinds of things. So keeping a healthy natural beach, which means don't armor it, let the vegetation stay over the shoreline. That overhanging vegetation is so important. There's great work going on all around the sound. We participate in a regional shore-friendly program that is part of this technical assistance for property owners in each community around the sound and even the outer coast, either through their marine resources committees or groups like Friends, has some of these grants like Shannon was talking about to help property owners kind of take those steps that they may not know sort of what's the right thing to do. So encourage folks to reach out to either their local government, their marine resources committee, or their nonprofit organization. And I'm happy if people, you know, I know a lot of those contacts. So if you want to just shoot me an email at tina@sanjuans.org, I'm happy to connect you with some of the salmon recovery folks in other communities.
Thanks, Tina. Okay, Lovell, this one's probably for you, from Jean Huffman. Was Friends in any way involved or even informed of the NOAA decision to allow the Navy to increase their take of southern resident killer whales from 2 to 50 per year based on the Navy's statement that the population was larger than widely believed?
Yeah, that is such an unfortunate decision. The final rule that NOAA published this past week, approving the application from the Navy. Friends of the San Juans, we commented and we joined with other organizations in commenting on that rulemaking. It's very concerning because even though the Navy says that this is a quote unquote level two take, not a level one, which would be fatalities, but still the disturbance and the impacts to the southern residents when there is such a critical status in terms of their population level is very concerning. So you know, we've engaged where we could, and it's just really unfortunate what the outcome of that rulemaking process was.
Thanks, Lovell. Okay, so how about, I think Jess, you could do this one, from Janet Alderton, who we all know as our board president. Hi, Janet, it's good to hear, see your name at least. Could you talk about the Anchor Out program to protect eelgrass?
Yeah, so we've been doing a big education outreach push to boaters coming into our area and visiting the islands, and also shoreline homeowners who may have buoy or moorage systems on our shorelines. But pretty much, eelgrass is a very sensitive habitat. As we know, it's all around the shallow waters that needs sunlight to grow. And so that's where it's kind of grown between 1 foot to 30 feet in the water. And one thing that we can do that's pretty easily to do, like there's a lot of things that are negatively impacting it, but one thing that we can control is anchor damage. So there's a variety of ways to do that. We put out a new map with a brochure last year that we're working hard to get in the hands of boaters. You can find it at
the Port of Friday Harbor right now and at West Marine and a variety of marinas around the islands. Contact us and we can get you one, or you can visit our green boating. Katie, what's our website?
SanJuans.org/greenboating.
That one. You can visit there to get the brochure and all the information. But pretty much we worked hard to provide more detailed information about the depths in certain specific areas of where eelgrass is growing to give boaters more information so they can anchor out of it. So it's not necessarily that you can't anchor. It's just if you anchor deeper in some spots, then you are clear and not damaging the eelgrass, which is something that is easily can be done. So that's part of the program is the education to boaters. And then Tina, do you want to talk about the outreach to shoreline owners part?
Sure. So another component of it, so there's the education piece about anchoring out of eelgrass. And then we also have sort of a restoration piece and a little more of kind of a policy piece. So I'm participating in a transboundary group. So we've got groups from Southern BC and the Gulf Islands, and also groups across Puget Sound, and we'll be installing more navigational buoys to mark the bays where the eelgrass is. So in addition to having a brochure, we'll have that really on the water sort of, you know, navigational marker that'll show you where the edge of the bed is to anchor out. And then we've got grant funding to work with interested property owners to get out old or unnecessary or upgrade outdated buoy and boating facilities. So for example, I've got property owners in herring spawning areas in Blind Bay and in East Sound that are willing to take out an old float and a few buoys. So we're in permitting for that. So working with shoreline property owners, focusing mostly on our herring spawning areas, which in our county is Mud and Hunter Bays on Lopez, East Sound on Orcas, West Sound on Orcas, and also Westcott and Garrison Bays. So next summer, hopefully before the boating season, if permitting all goes well, there will be those anchor out of eelgrass navigational buoys in East Sound. For those of you on Orcas, you know, well, everywhere on the islands, it was a busy boating season with the Canadian border closed. We and the marinas at half capacity, our anchorages are really feeling the impact. So San Juan County is installing more of these buoys. Northwest Straits is installing some of the buoys, and folks on the other side of the border, Sea Change and Parks Canada, will also be installing using the same branding, so we can really start ramping up the understanding across the whole region about how important eelgrass is.
Okay, Katie, it looks like we have time for one more question.
Okay, great, thanks, Michelle. All right, and like we said, those of you that we don't get to, we can, we'll get to you in other ways by email and answer your questions. We don't have too many left, though, and I also do want to encourage you all to go to our website, sanjuans.org, and kind of, look around there, too, just to kind of see more about what we're up to and maybe some answers to your questions, too. So the final question, Toby Cooper says, and this is for either Jess or Tina, a lot of interest in eelgrass tonight. Is there a relationship between eelgrass meadows and bull kelp beds, and does our work benefit those?
I'll start by just, I don't know the super scientific stuff that Tina can talk to, but I know just from taking Kaya Olson, who joined us tonight, and another young lady on Lopez, we went swimming and snorkeling off the south end of Lopez. I know that we were swimming in the eelgrass beds among Pacific sand lance, which is really exciting to see. It's my first time seeing firsthand. It's pretty cool after doing a lot of work to protect them, and seeing them in real life was exciting. And then we got to follow the sand lance right into a bull kelp bed. So they're definitely using both habitats. So equally important in my eyes. Tina?
Sure. So, I mean, the simple answer is everywhere where there isn't eelgrass, there's kelp. So kelp needs the rocky bottom, and eelgrass is mostly in our soft shore. So it's typically more in the embayments, but also in a lot of those pocket beaches. And the work that we do does impact them. So this work that we do to actually do active restoration, where we're taking out unnecessary things out of the water that are shading. Jess mentioned that eelgrass is a flowering plant. It needs sunlight to grow. It's our only marine flowering plant. And bull kelp sensitive to the same thing, sensitive to changes in water quality. Bull kelps are also really sensitive to oil spills and the chemicals that come from those. So in our voluntary efforts with the Preservation Trust to protect shoreline property and tideland properties, also protect those habitats. And those are the places that our baby salmon that are coming from across rivers, across the region, through the San Juans on their way to the open ocean, they're hiding in the eelgrass and kelps. That's a place where they get refuge and they find prey, and that's where they get bigger. And then when they're bigger, that's when they support the southern resident killer whales. So really all we do on our shorelines and just offshore where the eelgrass and kelp is such an important part of all the land use and our science and research and policy work.
Thank you, Tina. Okay, that concludes the meeting tonight. I'll go ahead and ask all of our staff to wave goodnight to everybody. And I'm sure those of you on the other side of your computers are waving goodnight too. Thank you, thank you. So yes, a huge thank you. A huge thank you to everybody who is here tonight and supports our work. We appreciate you so much. Cheers and good night.